real life as to what could go wrong in the criminal justice system, to understand that these things are serious.
Until all of us are willing to look at the reality of society that permits prosecutors to withhold evidence and to prosecute the innocent while the guilty go free, we'll never see a change. So I applaud Senator DeFrancisco and Assemblyman Perry and anybody else that stand up and fight against a system that allows this to go on. Me personally, I applaud anybody that goes against the system because I'm an underdog. I don't fight with a winning team, and I appreciate it if all the underdogs will start fighting for the people like me.
Senator DeFrancisco is the fighter we could all use on our sides. Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy. Hi, Senator.
Hello, how are you?
Great seeing you as always.
Thank you.
So, you're pointing out the criminal justice system. There's some flaws in the criminal justice system. Tell us what we were just seeing there.
Well, there's flaws in everything, but there's ways to correct some of the problems that arise, and that's what legislators are supposed to be for. And basically, the issue is this, that in many, many instances, most recently, because of DNA and the technology of DNA, we're finding more and more individuals who are wrongfully prosecuted and convicted of cases, even murder, that spend years upon years of their lives in jail and ultimately are exonerated by way of the DNA evidence that it couldn't have been them. And as they investigate, the courts investigate and the people investigate these cases, they find that there's a very strong common denominator, and that is that in many of those cases, most of those cases, the prosecutor who was prosecuting the case had favorable or exculpatory material that was never handed out over to the defense attorney, which it was supposed to be provided to them. That's what the law is. The Supreme Court in the Brady case made that the law. And for many, many years, prosecutors have violated that. Now, it's the law. They shouldn't violate it. But the real issue is, after people not only get out of jail, but they sue and end up recovering millions of dollars from the taxpayers of the state of New York, there's got to be a remedy. There's got to be something that's going to stop that from occurring. And up to this point in time, there hasn't been. And the bill I'm proposing would be such a remedy.
All right. So this commission, how would it be? Would they be appointed? Would they be voted for?
Basically, it's a prosecutorial conduct commission, and the purpose of it is to review prosecutor conduct. So if someone feels they're being mistreated or they have in some way been, the prosecutors violated the law, which affected them, there's an independent group of people appointed by the, some by the governor, some by the legislature, some by the Court of Appeals, Chief Justice, and people can get an independent review so that if something was done wrong, there's a consequence to the prosecutor who's done it wrong. Could be as high as removal, but more likely it's some sanction in some type, a reprimand, some type of acknowledgement to the public that this prosecutor did something wrong. Well, what the prosecutors say is, well, two things. We got two remedies. One, you can vote me out of office. Well, most prosecutorial terms are 4 years. A lot can be done in 4 years that causes problem to people to wait for the next election. In fact, in St. Lawrence County, we had a prosecutor who was castigated even by the State District Attorneys Association, and nothing happened. And the prosecutors also say there's a grievance committee in every area of the state. So if you got a grievance, you send it to the grievance committee. Not one prosecutor has ever been, that I know of, has ever been sanctioned by a grievance committee. Why? The members of the grievance committee are the local bar, most of whom are attorneys, if not all of whom are attorneys, who practice in that area. And a lot of them do criminal justice work. So if you've got somebody that's charged with a DWI and you want to try to get a plea bargain or try to get the case reduced, you might as well forget it if you're ever accusing the prosecutor of some type of wrongdoing. And that's just human nature. So the most important thing is that the judges have the same type of system. And that started in the 70s. And I remember back then when the judges were crying about how this is so unfair and they're doing the right thing and it's singling them out. Now judges don't even think about it because, number one, conduct has changed by judges. They're aware there's somebody out there, so they can't be so free to do anything they want. And secondly, a lot of these complaints end up in total exoneration of the judge. So it works both ways, and it's an effective system, and it gives people some confidence about the criminal justice system.
Yeah, and this is a bill that you've carried for years with Assemblyman Perry. So is the Assembly on board with it?
Well, everybody says they're on board with it, but to get it on the calendar for a vote, it's difficult because the prosecutors are dead set against it. And when you see the gentleman who spoke after me at the opening of the show, he was incarcerated. How many years he was incarcerated? And then they found that he didn't do it, and through, I think, DNA evidence. And then what happens? He's now lost a part of his life. The taxpayers, no doubt, are going to be spending some money for a wrongful prosecution case. And what happens to the prosecutor? Nothing. So what incentive is there to change conduct? Right. So, and this is it. I prosecuted cases for a while. This isn't an anti-prosecution bill. This is a good criminal justice reform bill that will put some check and balance mm-hmm. on the unlimited authority of prosecutors.
Yeah, and restore the faith in the criminal justice system.
You know, I don't know if it'll restore all the faith, but it'll at least give a remedy to those people who think they've been wronged and an independent body to review it.